Liz Truss is finally gone. The UK can't wait to see who the next PM will be and how he will clean up the mess. The US dollar, on the other hand, remains strong, and the dollar-yen trades above the 150 level for the very first time in more than 30 years. So welcome, this is Swissquote's daily market talk. So she's gone. The biggest news of yesterday was the resignation of the British PM Liz Truss after having wreaked havoc across all British asset classes in just 44 days in office, as she aimed to spend big but without a serious plan on how and who would finance all that spending. So in just 44 days, the British pound lost up to 8% against the euro, more than 10% against the US dollar. The 10-year gilt yield rose 55%, while the 30-year gilt yield skyrocketed 60%. And if the Bank of England hadn't been there, the pension funds in the UK would just collapse. Why? Well, again, because the markets just said a very clear no to Liz Truss' mini budget, which has clearly nothing mini apart from its name as such. Well, that maxi misstep costed Liz Truss her seat as a PM, and she now goes down in history as the shortest serving PM in Britain's history. The news wasn't a surprise at all. As you know, we all expected that outcome. Now, normally, a PM resignation means uncertainty and limited visibility, so it's not a preferred scenario for the markets. But the little time Liz Truss stayed in power was so hectic that investors simply welcomed the news that she departs sooner rather than later. Sterling and the British sovereigns rallied yesterday, although cable is back below the 112 level at the time I'm talking here this morning. And of course, what happened in the UK over the past weeks is also a warning for the new PM and his or her team that there are limits that cannot be breached in this budget story, and financial discipline is one of those. Britain learned it the hard way. Now everyone is holding their breath to find out who will replace Liz Truss. The new PM needs at least 100 votes from their colleagues to become the new PM, and Rishi Sunak seems like the best option right now. The previous Chancellor of Exchequer has a very solid track record. He actually knows he can't spend or he can't make tax decisions without justification. He knows that despite the unideal economic conditions right now across the world, not only in the UK, he can't increase debt without increasing the cost of borrowing. And more importantly, and this is really important, he is supported by the market. Then you have Penny Mordaunt, that could be another candidate that could replace Liz Truss by next week. And finally, it is also reported that Boris Johnson could be back in the race. Now, according to a YouGov survey, which doesn't mean anything for the actual vote, but Boris Johnson is one of the favorite candidates. And why not? You know, he quit because of several scandals, but at the end of the day, partying, for example, was not a big deal compared to Liz Truss, who actually destroyed confidence in the UK government and almost killed the pension system of the country. So Boris Johnson all of a sudden becomes very, very soft in all these. Anyway, whoever it is, the main challenge for the next UK PM will be to reassure the markets. We actually expect to see some more bumpy trading for the British assets until the dust settles, and in this respect, cable will likely see a strong resistance around its 50-day moving average level, which stands near 114.40 and the 115 psychological mark. And we could see actually the pair test the 110 mark yet again. But keep in mind that the latest British turmoil could also be an interesting opportunity to return to British assets at quite interesting prices. Now, zooming out, the US dollar continues extending its rally across the board, and there is nothing that the other currencies could do about it. The dollar yen is now trading above the 150 level with prospects of another BOJ intervention. The Japanese inflation, on the other hand, remained unchanged near 3% in September, so it's almost an 8-year high level. The import prices in Japan, due to the weakening yen, is one of the major reasons for the rise in consumer prices in Japan. But the Bank of Japan is not willing to hike the interest rates just yet. Therefore, the Bank of Japan intervention in the FX markets will offer dip buying opportunities for those who continue betting for a further dive in the Japanese yen against the US dollar. And it's not only the BOJ. Turks are not willing to hike interest rates either. They prefer cutting rates instead. The Central Bank of Turkey cut the interest rates by 150 basis points yesterday versus 100 basis point fall expected by analysts. We knew that Erdogan was forcing the central bank to cut rates yet again, so the move wasn't a surprise per se. And as sad as it sounds, there is little difference between a 100 or a 150 basis point cut at this stage, because 10, 11, 12% levels for Turkish rates are meaningless anyway when official inflation hangs above 80%. So the lira didn't move much following the news, as the central bank didn't allow it to, thanks to heavy FX intervention. So moving forward from here, the dollar try will likely continue trending higher slowly, as long as the Turkish central bank could afford it, and faster the day they can no longer afford it. And as I always say, the currency control makes betting against the Turkish lira fruitless at the moment. Even though Turkey is now the country that offers the lowest real interest rate on the face of this world. To me, you know that it's a time bomb. It's not sustainable in long term, but no one really knows when and how the Erdogan's rate saga will end. For now, we know that the Turkish stocks are pretty much the best and the only option to hedge against the rising inflation in Turkey. The BIST 100 index advanced past the 3900 level yesterday, as Turkish Airlines traded past the 100 lira mark. I'm actually intrigued by Turkish Airlines because despite the rising fuel costs, the war in Ukraine put the Turkish airline company at the heart of a massive traffic between Russia and the rest of the Western world, and that should actually continue boosting the company's revenues in the current quarter as well. The company recorded an almost 8% rise in passengers compared to the same time in 2019. That was a before pandemic performance, and increased its occupancy ratio to above 85%. Now the company is due to announce its earnings in the coming weeks, and it will actually be very, very interesting in my opinion to see the impact of the Ukrainian war on Turkish Airlines business. Now it's not only the Turkish Airlines that looks like it's doing well. American Airlines revenue also rose 13% last quarter compared to the same time in 2019, while they flew 10% less. Now, the higher prices help compensate rising fuel and labor costs. The company also said that they will get back to their full 2019 capacity by next year. United Airlines and Delta Airlines also said that they would be profitable through the end of the year, and that thanks to strong bookings and fares. But alas, American Airlines still fell 3.80% yesterday and remains under a decent selling pressure as the S&P 500 closed 0.80% lower. Snap, on the other hand, nosedived 27% in the after-hours trading after reporting the lowest ever quarterly sales growth due to lower advertising spending. And on the macroeconomic front, while the US Philly Fed manufacturing index came in softer than expected, but the weekly jobless claims in the US fell, which certainly helped fueling the hawkish Federal Reserve expectations yet again. There are now a couple of theories around about why the US jobless claims continue falling, whereas they should normally slow down due to the economic slowdown and the worsening economic conditions. But first, it could be that the labor shortage was so bad last year that businesses actually prefer keeping their workers to not lack labor when the slowdown reverses. Or there are plenty of job openings out there, which means that people could actually jump from job to job without asking for jobless benefits. And third, well, the US economy hasn't slowed enough to cause higher unemployment claims. Well, ironically, Luckily, the latter is obviously the worst case scenario for the market and asset prices, as it's the one that could push the Federal Reserve to tighten its policy more and send stock prices further down. So this is all for this week. I'm İpek Özkardeşkaya, and thank you for joining me and for all your comments. I hope this episode of Market Talk has also been helpful and insightful to you. So please do not hesitate to leave your comments, your reactions, and your questions below as usual. And follow us on Instagram, on Twitter, and on LinkedIn for regular market updates. And subscribe, of course, to our YouTube channel for daily market comments. I meet you again next week. And until then, good day trading and have a lovely weekend.